Hello and welcome to STQB Foundation Level Syllabus. And here we are going to continue with chapter number 1, that is Fundamentals of Testing. So until now we covered what is testing, why is testing necessary, and in the last lecture we covered 7 testing principles. Now in this lecture we are going to cover the test process. This is also one of the important topic. It's a very big topic. But you are going to get only one question from this part. So it has 4 subtopics. First, you need to know the context of the test process. So test process is context dependent, and how they are context dependent, that is what we are going to see here. Then we have to describe the test activities and respective tasks within the test process. So test process is a big term. Inside test process we have test activities, and each test activities we have different tasks, and that is what we have to see in this chapter. The third topic is differentiate the work product that supports the test process. So as I said, test process is a big activity. Inside that we have test activities. When we perform test activities, there are certain tasks. So once we complete our task, what we will get the output. So we need to know for which test process, what is the output? That is what we are going to see in chapter in the third topic. And the last topic is explain the value of maintaining traceability between the test basis and test work product. So why we should make the traceability? So this traceability concept we will understand in detail in the last topic. So these are the 4 topics which we are going to cover under test process. So before we start, what we should know is the overview of the test process. So what is a test process? A test process is the set of interrelated activities. It is a set of interrelated activities. What are the activities? First we need to know. It comprises of test planning, test monitoring and control, test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution, and test completion. All these things together constitutes test process. Therefore, we say a test process is a set of interrelated activities comprising of test planning, monitoring and control, analysis, design, implementation, execution, and completion. So what you need to remember is it is a interrelated activities. Next. Why we need this test process? What is the need of test process? So in an organization, there are different peoples with different roles assigned to them. For an example, we have business analyst, we have technical analyst, we have testers, we have business representatives, we have business sponsors, automation specialist, and many more roles. Now, for them to work in a synchronized way, and so that they know that what will happen first, what will happen second, what will happen third, they know this clearly to avoid any type of miscommunication in within the team. We need test process. So this is all about test process. Now what we need to know is, before we proceed further, what are the keywords which we are going to cover under this topic. So starting, we saw these are the different keywords which we should cover in chapter number 1. Out of this, the majority of the keywords will be covered now under this topic, like test analysis. You will understand what is the meaning of test analysis, test basis, test cases, test completion, test condition, test control, test data, test design, test execution, implementation, monitoring, test object, objective of test, then test oracle, planning, procedures, process, test suites. So all these things you should know, and you should know the difference between them. That should be our approach when we complete this topic. And there are 2 more, testware and traceability. So whenever we come across these words, please pay more attention. So here I have listed down few keywords which are very important Before we proceed further, or if we want to understand the complete topic, the topic number 4, we need to understand these terms properly and the difference between them. The first term is test basis. The body of knowledge used as the basis for test analysis and design. It is a body of knowledge. And why it is used? It is used for analysis and design purpose. In a very simple term, what you can say is requirement is nothing but the test basis. The requirement document which you get is a test basis. But in ISTQB syllabus, they have used the term test basis. So based on this, we perform our testing. That's why the name test basis. The body of knowledge used as the basis for test analysis and design. Let's understand this. This is a very important term. All these terms are very important. So we have to understand these terms. Suppose this is the requirement, that means test basis. We got it from the customer. We need a light system which will glow when door is open and close when door is closed. So light will glow when the door is open, light will switch off when the door is closed. The system shall work like mentioned. After reading this requirement, what we need to do is we have to find out, so we are analyzing the requirement now. This is the test basis. We have to find out the test conditions. First, we got the test basis. Based on this, we have to perform testing. Now, test condition. A testable aspect of a component or system identified as a basis for testing. Here, what we are doing? We are identifying the testable aspect of the requirement. So as I have given you this example, this was the test basis where everything is there. Now we have to find out what are the test conditions, what all things we can test in it. So these are the two things which we can test. For example, light shall glow when door is open, light shall not glow when door is closed. So this is the point or this is the part which is relevant for the testing purpose. So this is what we have to extract from the main document or from the test basis. Once we have the test condition, the next step is the test cases. What are the test cases? A set of preconditions, inputs, actions, expected results, and post conditions developed based on test condition. This is important, based on test condition. So we have a test condition. By looking into the test condition, what we need to do is we have to write down the test cases. So this is a test design where we have two test cases. So based on these two conditions, we are writing two test cases. First one, switch on power because we need a battery to turn these things on. Then open the door and then check that the light is on and then switch off the power supply. So here this is the precondition. This is the action which we are taking and this is the post condition. Once your work is done, you should switch off the power supply. And the second condition is similar to that, then again switch on the power supply, close the door, check that the lights are off now, and then switch off the power supply. So these are the two test cases which we derived from the test condition, and the test conditions are derived from the test basis. So this is the main document on which testing depends on. I hope now the points are clear. Now the next point is test procedure. A sequence of test cases in execution order. So we have the test cases, but we have to keep them in an order so that we can execute them. We will see what is the meaning of that. A sequence of test cases in execution order and any associated actions that may be required to set up the initial precondition and any wrap-up activities post condition. What they are trying to say is that first of all, we will have lots of test cases when we are analyzing the test conditions. Then these test cases, we have to arrange them in an order so that we can execute them. In that, we also have to see that once the first test case is done, can we run the second test case or not? Or do we need to take care of certain things in between? So there are certain parameters which we disable before we start running the next test cases so that there is no influence of test case 1 on test case 2. We want to avoid the influence of test case 1 on test case 2, and that is what we take care here. Initial preconditions and any wrap-up post-execution thing. Okay. Now comes test data. Data needed for test execution. So when we want to execute the test cases, so normally execution is the term which is used for the automation testing. So let's see what is the meaning of test data. So we have power supply here, right? Switch on power supply, but we didn't tell how much power we have to give. So it is 12 volt. Then door status. So when we will consider the door is open, when we will consider the door is closed. So when 0 we give, that means door is off. When we give 1, that means the door is on. So these are the data which we need to feed to the test cases so that it can execute automatically. So this is all about test data. Data needed for test execution. So all the data which you need for your execution are referred as test data. Then what is test suits? A set of test scripts or test procedures to be executed in a specific order or in a specific test run. So test suits are like this. You can have multiple test cases, like you can have test case 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like until 11. But then in a test suite, what you do is you group them. So once you execute the first test suite, that is the set 1, only test case 2, 4 and 11 will be executed. Similarly, when you select the second test suite, then test case 1, 3 and 7 will execute. So you are grouping the test cases in some order. That is called test suites. What is testware? So whatever output you get from the testing environment, when you are doing testing, whatever you give as an output are referred as testware. For example, test cases, test conditions, results, test environment, everything comes under testware. So work products produced during the test process for use in planning, design, execution, evaluation and reporting on testing. So any document which we produce or which we get during the testing phase are referred as testwares. Now the very important term, that is test oracle. I have seen a lot of questions based on this. So let's see what is the meaning of test oracle. A source to determine an expected result to compare with the actual result for the system under test. So during testing, what we do? We measure the result, we get the result, we compare it with the expected result. So this expected result we have to store somewhere. That place is called test oracle. Test oracle is a source to determine an expected result so that we can compare that with the actual result. So I hope now it is clear what is test oracle. It is just a storage place where we store the expected result. With this, we covered all the topics. Let's summarize them one by one quickly. So the first term which we saw is test basis. It is the body of knowledge used as the basis for test analysis and design. In a simple term, test basis is nothing but the requirement. Second, test condition is defined as a testable aspect of a component or system identified as a basis for testing. Next, test case is defined as a set of preconditions, inputs, actions, expected results, and pre-post conditions developed based on test condition. So test cases we develop based on test condition. Test conditions we get from the test basis. Next, test procedure. Test procedure is a sequence of test cases in execution order and any associated actions that may be required to set up the initial preconditions and any wrap-up activities post-execution. Next, test suite is defined as a set of test scripts or test procedures to be executed in a specific test run. So here we are grouping the test cases. During test suits, what we do, we group the test cases or test scripts and test procedures. Test data is defined as data needed for test execution. So whatever data we need for the execution are referred as test data. Testware. is defined as work product produced during the test process. So whatever work product, whatever output you produce during the test process, for example, during the planning stage, design stage, execution stage, evaluation stage, reporting stage, whatever data you produce are referred as testware. Test oracle, a source to determine an expected result to compare with the actual result of the system under stage, under test. Test oracle is a storage, it is a place where we store the expected results. So I hope all these points are clear. You can pause the video and go through these points. They are very important for the upcoming lecture. Next, test process context. So this is the first topic which we need to now understand under test process. So until now, whatever we saw is the overview so that we can understand these topics. Okay. So here we have to explain the impact of context on the test process. So we have test process, and what are the different factors that can influence test process, or what are the different context which can influence the test process? That is what we need to understand here. First of all, there is an ISO standard in which test process is defined or explained. ISO, IEC, IEEE 29192. This is a ISO standard in which the test process is explained in detail. For the exam point of view, you don't have to remember, but we will not take any chance. So at the end, what I will do is I will provide you the list of all the ISOs which we are going to cover in chapter number 1. Okay. So for time being, just remember 29192 is a standard in which test processes are defined. Let's move further. So contextual factors that influences the test procedure for an organization are, so when you introduce a test process in an organization, there are some context related factors which will influence them or influence it. They are software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. So what type of software model you are using, that will influence the test process which you are going to follow or which you are going to select. Test levels and test types being considered. So at what level of testing you are doing, or what type of testing you are doing, that will also influence the test process. Product and project risk. What is the risk associated with your project? That will also influence your test process. Business domain. In which type of business you are in, that will also influence the test process. Operational constraints. So for operating a project within an organization, what are the different factors which will influence the test process? That is what we will see here. And then organizational policies and practices. So what are the policies which your organization is following or which you have to follow, that will also influence the test process. And last one, required internal and external standards. So what are the standards which we should fulfill for our product, that will also influence the test process. So these are the different factors which will affect the selection of test process. Now we will see them in detail, each of these steps, each of these context in detail. So the first context is software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. So what type of software development lifecycle model we are using? For example, when we use V model, that time we go for the incremental process, whereas when we follow agile model, we go for the iterative process. We will cover this topic in more detail in the second chapter, but just as an overview, let's have a look. So when I talk about software development lifecycle model, that is about V model. So this is how a V model looks like. So here we do testing once the first stage is completed, and we perform testing in a parallel way. What does this mean? We will cover in chapter number 2, as I said, but for time being, this is the V model. And if we select this model, the way we test will change compared to the agile model. Agile model is a more iterative model. Every week you have to perform testing. So you have to select a process which will fulfill that, which will be a complementary to what you want to do in your agile development model. So this is a V model, this is an agile model. Okay, and if you select any of this model, your test process, the way you approach or the way or the test process you select will be different. So this is the first point, software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. Next one, test levels and test types being considered. When we say test levels, again, all the test levels and test types we will cover in chapter number 2. We will just see the overview over here. So if you are at the component level or integration testing level or system testing level or at acceptance testing level, at each of this level, the way you test will change, and based on that you have to select the test process. Similarly, when you do different type of testing, for example, when you perform functional testing or you perform non-functional testing, white box testing, change related testing, your approach is different. That's why we say test level and test type being considered influences the test process. Next factor, product and project risk. Suppose you are working for an automotive industry, or if you are working for an avionic industry, obviously the risk over here is big. If something fails here, then it will cost life of a lot of people. Whereas if something fails in the car, then also it's a threat to the life, but the impact is comparatively less. So based on what product we are using, we have to select the test process. Here the testing is going to be more rigorous compared to the automotive project. So remember, product and project risk influences the test process. Next, business domain. This is quite simple. Suppose you are working for an e-commerce. So here, the software which you will build for the billing purposes, it should be in a position to handle different load conditions, right? Whereas when you are working for the security related product, then the objective is to see that the software is secure enough or not. And since the objective is different, to achieve this objective, we will have a different type of test process. So business domain also influences the test process. Next one, operational constraints. So when you are working in an organization, there are certain constraints. For example, budget and resources. If you don't have enough budget, then you cannot repeat the testing cycle again and again. Time scale. If the duration is less, that time also you cannot perform multiple testing cycles. If the product is very complex, the technology is new, then you may not know what all type of testing you should perform on it. Then you may have to go for different type of approach. Then contractual and regulatory requirements. So what contract you signed when you got this project, based on that also you have to change your test process. So operational constraints are budget and resources, time scale, complexity, contract and regulatory requirements. Next, organizational policies and practices. Okay, so we already saw the development model in your organization, what type of development model they are using. Based on that, the test process will change, and what type of strategy they are doing, like test planning, which type of test techniques they are using, which type of tools they are using, that will also influence that test process which you are going to follow. So organizational policies and practices. The last one, required internal and external standards. So there are two standards, like ISO 26262, that is for the automotive industry. Here the main concern is about the safety, whereas ASPICE is also an automotive standard. Here we focus on the process related stuff. So based on what type of standard you have in your organization, the test process will change. So let's summarize all the context which we saw till now. The first one is software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. Test levels and test types being considered. Product and project risk, business domains, operational constraints like business budget and resources, time scale, complexity, contractual and regulatory requirements, organizational policies and practices, required internal and external standards. So these are some of the factors or context based on which we have to select the test process. Now, we have to see in an organization how the test process is implemented. What are the different part in it? So there is three general aspects. The first one is test activity and task. So under test process, what are we going to have? We are going to have a test activity. Under this test activity, we will have different tasks. When we perform this task, we will get the output. That output is referred as test work product. Once we have different work products, we have to provide the traceability between them so that we know that this work product belongs to which test process. Okay, so there are three general aspects. First one is test activity and task, test work product, and traceability. Let's understand that in more detail. So this is a general aspect of organizational test process. Okay, we have generalized the test process here, but based on the organization, based on the context, it can change, it may change. So now the first one, what we saw is that the activities. So these are the activities which are listed down here. There are 7 activities. You have to remember them in the same order it is listed, because in the exam they may ask you the correct order. So first one is test planning. Then comes test monitoring and control, test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution, test completion. So these are the different activities. When we say test planning, inside test planning there will be different tasks which we will see in the upcoming lecture. Similarly, when we say the analysis test, there are different tasks which we are going to do. When we perform the task under these activities, what we get is we get the output, and the output is referred as work product. For an example, when you are in the planning stage, whatever activity you do at the end, what you will get? You will get the test plan. Similarly, when you are monitoring and controlling, what you will get? You will get the test progress report. So that is the output of this stage. When you are in the analysis stage, that time you will get the prioritized test conditions. When you are in the design stage, you will get the test cases. When you are in the implementation stage, you will get test suites. When you are in the execution stage, the output is defect report. And when you complete your task, then you will have a finalized testware. As I said, testware means output of each stage. So finally, we will summarize all the outputs, or we will collect all the outputs. I hope till now it is clear. Under test process, we have test activities. Under test activities, we have different tasks. These are the different test activities. Inside each activity, we have different tasks. When we perform these tasks, we get the output. The output is referred as work product. Now what we need to do is, these work products are individual. We should know which test case belongs to which test condition. For that reason, we have the traceability. Let's first understand what is traceability, and then we will see the definition over here. So now we are going to see the traceability concept. Suppose you have the requirement from the customer. Okay, requirement 1, 2, 3, 4. Likewise, you can have n number of requirements, like 1000, 2000, 10,000 requirements you may get from the customer. Then, based on this requirement, after analysis, after finding the test condition, what you are going to do is, you are going to write the test cases. So let's say the number is test case 1, test case 2, test case 3, test case 4. Likewise, until n number of test cases you can have. Now, the question comes, how you will come to know which test case belongs to which requirement? For that reason, we need the traceability. It is not necessary that test case 1 belongs to requirement 1 only. We can have a jumbled up test cases here. For example, test case 2 belongs to test case, requirement 2 belongs to test case number 4. Requirement 3 belongs to the last test case. Likewise, we can have multiple links. So these are the virtual links. Once you click on the test case, you can see that it is referred to which requirement. Similarly, when you click on the requirement, you will see that it is covered by which test case. It is a bi-directional link. So this is the concept of traceability. Once you have the output, you should know that the output belongs to which test case. And that is what is written over here. Traceability is to maintain traceability throughout the test processes between each element of the test basis. Each element of the test basis means each element of the requirement and the various test work product, between the requirement and the work product associated with that element. So we have requirement, we have different output, we have to link to that, link it to the requirements, and for that we need the traceability concept. We will cover traceability concept in more detail in the fourth subtopic. So what you need to now know is, as we have already seen, the test process is defined under 29.119.2 standard, whereas test work product is defined under 29.119.3 standard. First we will have a test process. Once we perform the task, then only we will get the work product. So that's why you can remember 2 is less, 3 is more, means 3 should come afterwards. So once we perform the test process, then only we will get the work product. So that way also you can remember it, whether 2 belongs to test process or 3 belongs to test process. Okay, 3 belongs to the test work product because it is the output of the test process. So it will come in the later stage. This is just for remembering purpose. Okay, I don't know why this number like this, but just to remember, this is the concept which we can follow. 29.119.2 is for test process. 29.119.3 is for the test work product. Moving further, let's summarize all the points which we saw till now. So there are three aspects of organization and test process. Those are test activity and task, test work product, and traceability. And then 29.119.2 is for test process, 29.119.3 is for test work product. Now what are we going to see is the first test activity. The first activity is test planning. So you need to understand here what is the meaning of test planning. Again, this topic is covered in more detail in chapter number 5. So here we are just going to see the overview of it. So as we know, test planning is the first activity of test process. And here we have three main activities. So under test planning, maybe task, we can say task. We have three main tasks. Defining the test objective. We have to define the objective of our testing. Defining the test approach. And updating the test plan based on feedback. Let's understand all these three points in detail. First is defining the test objective. So during planning, we have to ask questions like what to test, how to test, and when to test. Defining the objective. So in the test planning, we will have a complete roadmap. What we are going to test, how are we going to test, and when we are going to test these things. All these details will be there in the test planning. Next one is, so this is the test plan which I already explained. Next is defining the test approach. It also includes approach from meeting the test objective within the constraints imposed by the context. So if you remember, initially we saw these are the different objectives. So this is what we have to achieve when based on the context, we have to select the test approach. Okay, so these are the context or the objective. Based on the context, what we have to do is we have to define the test approach. In which product we want to test, based on that product, we should change our approach or we should select our approach. Next one, updating plan based on the feedback. So testing is not a one-time activity. It's not like that in the starting of the project you did planning once and then that is all, that is enough. It's not like that. We need feedback, because while working it is possible that we may deviate from actual plan. Deviate means whatever is planned, we are not as per the plan. We are deviating from it, from the actual plan. That's why we need feedback mechanism to monitor the progress. So what it means is, so this is a test plan. What we did is we are telling when the test will start, when the design activity will start, when the implementation activity will start, when it will end, and when the software will release. But during this time, if we see that whatever test cases we wanted to build, we could not build it, we are behind the schedule, then that feedback will go to the monitoring stage, and then monitoring stage will update the planning stage, and then we have to update our planning. We can include more resources, we can increase the timeline, anything, there are many factors, but that input should go to the planning stage. Okay, that is the reason we say we have to update the plan based on the feedback. So these are the three main important points which we need to consider during planning stage. So I can summarize the points now. The three main tasks of test planning are defining the test objective, defining the test approach, and updating the plan based on the feedback. This is all about the planning stage. Now we will move to the test monitoring and control stage. So this is the second stage in the test process. The first stage is test planning, and the second stage is test monitoring and control. We need to understand why test monitoring is necessary. First of all, why we need this stage? So let's understand the overview. So we know that test plan is a point where we define the, or we where we have a roadmap for the upcoming activities. We say that when the test will start, when the analysis will start, and when the test will finish, and we will release the software to the customer. But during execution, we see that there is some problem in the test environment and we are not able to correct it on time. Then what we need to do is, to find such effects, the monitoring stage comes into picture. At each stage, we will have a monitoring mechanism like this. At each stage, we will be monitoring and we will see that whatever we planned for this state, are we able to achieve that or not? If not, then from the monitoring stage, we will have a two-way communication and we will communicate to the test planning stage. And that is why the monitoring stage is required, so that if we are deviating from the plan, we can update the planning sheet. Now the question comes, what is test monitoring and control? Is it same? Monitoring means and control means same, and how they are different? Monitoring means what and control means what? So when we say test monitoring, what we actually doing here is, it involves the ongoing comparison of actual progress against planned progress using any test monitoring metrics defined in the test plan. So during monitoring, what we do is, we compare the actual progress of that stage with the planned progress. During planning, we will tell that, okay, within a week we should have 100 test cases run. But if we see that in the first day or second day, we only executed 10 test cases, that means we are behind the schedule. In 2 days, if we are testing only 10 feature, how can we test 100 test cases in 5 days? Not possible. So this is what the monitoring will do. It will do the actual progress. It will compare the actual progress with the planned progress. This is what we do in the monitoring stage. Next is test control. What we do here is, it involves taking necessary actions to meet the objective of the plan. For an example, I gave you, during the execution stage, we wanted to run 100 test cases, but in 2 days we ran only 10 test cases. So now as an action, as a control, what we need to do is, we can deploy more resources, more people to the project, so that they can execute and we can speed up the thing. or we can find out what is the problem, try to correct that so that it can be finished on time, or we can increase the deadline. Any of the things we can do, but those are the control activities. Control activity will come into picture only when there is a deviation between the actual progress and the planned progress. So then what is the meaning of test monitoring and control? Are supported by the evaluation of exit criteria. Exit criteria means, as we said, 100 test cases. In 5 days, we have to complete 100 test cases. That is the exit criteria. That is the target, which are referred to as the definition of done in some software development lifecycle model. So this exit criteria is referred as definition of done. Definition of done means in 5 days, if you complete 100 test cases, that means you have achieved what we wanted in the planning stage. And that is what test monitoring and control try to do. I hope you understood what is test monitoring, what is test control, and how they are different. Now we talked about the exit criteria, right? In the previous slide, I told exit criteria means what we should achieve, the target. So we have to evaluate the exit criteria during this stage. How we can evaluate the exit criteria? By checking the test result and log against the specified coverage criteria. So initially we will specify like 100% requirement should cover. Then we have to check whether 100% requirement is covered or not. That is the evaluation against the exit criteria. Next point is assessing the level of component or system quality based on the test result and logs. So we can say that once the testing is done, we should have only 10 open defects. Okay, once the testing is done, we should have only 10 open defects. If we have more than 10 open defects, that means the quality is bad. So this is one metric. So we have to assess the quality of the software based on the result. And next one is determining if more tests are needed. So we will see, we have planned, okay, 10 test cases we will execute. But we have to see that during the planning stage, is 10 test cases enough? If we are finding more bugs, then can we write more test cases to test this feature? So not only restricting to what we have planned, but to see that whether we can add something to the planning or not. For that also, we have to evaluate the product or monitor the product. So evaluation of criteria includes checking, assessing, and determining. And why we want to do monitoring stages, the important factor is communication to the stakeholder. We will have all the data, what we wanted, what we achieved. By having this data, we can communicate with the stakeholders. Test progress against the plan, what we planned and how much we have achieved, that we can communicate to the stakeholder. Next, deviations from the plan. Whatever we plan, like 100 test cases we plan and we only completed 90 test cases, so this deviation we can record. Next, information to support any decision to stop testing. If the software is not working fine in the first day itself, we can say that the software is unstable and we cannot test it. So such type of decision we can take if we are monitoring it continuously. And then we can communicate it to the corresponding stakeholders. It could be manager or the customer or the lead, anyone. We can communicate the status to them. For that, monitoring is very much required. So this is all about test control and monitoring stage, or monitoring and control stage. We will learn more about it in the fifth chapter. But as of now, what we will do is we will summarize all the points which we saw till now. First point is, test monitoring involves the ongoing comparison of actual progress against planned progress using any test monitoring matrices defined in the test plan. Okay, so some matrices we have defined in the test plan. Based on that, we do the comparison. Test control involves taking necessary actions or actions necessary to meet the objective of the test plan. So whatever we plan during the planning stage, whether we have to achieve that, and for that we can perform some necessary actions, and that is called the test control activity. Test monitoring and control are supported by the evaluation of exit criteria, which are referred to as the definition of done in some software development lifecycle model. Evaluation of exit criteria includes assessing and determining the test activities. Main activities of test monitoring and control are, so there are some main activities. First of all, to check the test result and log against specified coverage criteria. The level of component or system quality based on the test results and logs. To determine if more tests are needed to gain the confidence. And to inform the stakeholders about test progress against the plan, any deviation from the plan, or any information to support and any decision to stop testing. So these are the different points which comes from the test monitoring and control stage. So you can pause the video and just go through it twice and thrice so that this topic is done for you. Now what we are going to do is we are going to the next stage, that is test activities definition. So until now we covered two activities. Now we will see the remaining activities, but before going to the remaining activities, because they all are interrelated, we will see their definition so that we can understand the topic properly. So in the previous session we covered impact of context on the test process. This is what we have seen. Now what we are continuing with is test activities and respective tasks within the test process. So we have to see the test activity and we have to see what are the tasks we perform under that. So till now we covered test planning and test monitoring. Now we are going to see test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution and test completion processes. For that we need to understand the meaning. During test analysis, the test basis is analyzed. During the analysis stage, what we are doing? We are analyzing the test basis. Test basis means requirement. So we are analyzing the requirement. Why? To identify testable features and identify associated test conditions. We analyze the requirement so that we identify the testable feature and the associated test conditions. We already saw the example of it. So when we are at the test analysis stage, what we need to do is we have to ask question, what we should test, what to test. This is a question which you should ask during the test analysis stage. What I mean by that is, here the first thing is test basis is analyzed, that you should know that requirement is analyzed during this stage. So this is the requirement which we got. It is the same requirement which we discussed previously. We need a light system which will glow when door is open and close when the door is closed. The system shall work like mentioned. So this is what we have to analyze. After analyzing, what we need to do, we have to identify the testable feature. So out of these, the last line is of no use, and then we can have a testable feature like this. Light shall glow when door is open and close when door is closed. So this is the testable feature that we have identified. After that, what we have to do is we have to identify the test conditions. So inside this, we have two test conditions. Light shall glow when door is open. Light shall not glow when door is closed. So these are the test conditions which we get after analyzing the requirement, that is test basis. So remember this point. During test analysis, you ask question what to test, and there we see, we analyze the requirement, we identify the testable feature, and then finally we define the test conditions. Next, test analysis. So this is what we saw, the definition. During test analysis, the test basis is analyzed to identify testable feature and define associated test conditions. I am repeating it again and again so that you by heart hear itself. The next definition is test design. During test design, the test conditions are elaborated into. So here what we are doing during test design, we are getting test condition as an input. For test design stage, test condition is the input. And in this test, we are elaborating it. We are expanding it further to a high level test cases. Now we are writing high level test cases or set of high level test cases or other test ways. So that means during test design, we write the high level test cases from where? From the test condition. Let's see that. So during test design, we should ask how to test. So previously we asked what to test. Now we have to ask a question, how to test. So we have a test condition. So how we can test it? That is what we will answer in the test design stage. The test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases. What we are doing here is we are elaborating the test conditions into high level test cases. So until now we saw in the previous stage, that is the analysis stage, we got the test condition from the test basis. In this stage, what we do is we write the test design. During that, for these two test conditions, we wrote the two test cases. Then, identification of defect in the test basis. So when you read the test condition, if you find any defect in it, you have to report it. So identification of defect in the test basis. So finding the defect in the test basis happens in the design stage. Please remember this point. We do two things. First one is the test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases or set of high level test cases. And other than that, we also identify the defect in the test basis. This is very important. So this is the test design definition. During test design, the test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases and set of high level test cases. Moving to the next test activity, that is test implementation. So what we do here is, during test implementation, the test wears, that means the output necessary for test execution is created. So whatever we need for the test execution, we create all those things during the test implementation stage. So this concept you have to remember. Whatever we need to execute the test cases are implemented or prepared during the test implementation stage. Execution is created or completed, including sequencing the test cases into test procedure. So what at the end you need to know is, during test implementation, we have to make everything ready so that during test execution, we can just execute the test cases. Let's understand it in more detail. Test implementation. So here we have to ask a very important question. Do we have everything now to test? So next stage is a execution stage where the actual testing will take place. So we should ensure that during the implementation stage that we have everything to test. We have to see that the test ways necessary for the test execution is created or completed. So for our requirement, we need a computer, we need a software, we need a switch to switch on and switch off, we need a power supply, we need a battery, we need a door or miniature version of the door or simulation of the door and the light. All these things should be ready. The test environment should be ready during the test implementation stage. Next, sequencing the test cases into test procedure. So you know that in the previous stage we wrote the test case, yes, in the design stage. In this stage, we have to divide it into low-level test cases. What does that mean? First of all, we have to sequence them, like we have to arrange them in order in which we want them to execute. So during execution, we just want to execute. So the arrangement, we have to do it in the test implementation stage. Similarly, for the test scripts also. We can write the test scripts during test implementation stage. So these are the things which we do in the implementation stage. So what you need to remember is, during test implementation, we make everything ready which is necessary for the execution stage. That is the main purpose over here. Next one, test execution. This is the stage where we are executing the test cases. During test execution, test suits are run in accordance with the test execution schedule. So test suits are created during the test implementation stage, and we will just use this suit and run it, and that will be referred as test execution stage. So let's have a look into it. So during test execution, what we do is we check whether we have run all the test cases or not, because that is what we have to do in this stage. Test suits are run, so all the test cases will be run in the same order in which they were arranged during the test implementation stage. Compare and evaluate the result. So once you execute the test case, what you will get? You will get the measured result. Then that measured result you will compare with the expected result. And if both are same, the test case will pass. If there is a deviation, then the test case will fail. So this is what you need to do. You have to run all the test suits, and then you have to compare and evaluate the results during the test execution stage. And you have to ask question, are all tests run? So during test execution, test suits are run in accordance with the test execution schedule. Test completion. This is the last stage, seventh step. Test completion activities collect data from completed test activities. So all the activities which we completed previously, for example, analysis, design, implementation, execution, they will have output. We have to collect all the output and consolidate the experiences. Not only the output, we also have to consolidate the experiences. What went wrong during the testing? What went good? Can we follow it in the next release? What we should avoid for the next release? All those things will be documented in the completion stage. And any other relevant information. So whatever relevant information we have with respect to the testing process, we have to document it during the test completion stage. So this is all about the test steps. Now let's see what are the different test activities or processes and the documents related to that. So during the planning stage, what we have, we will have the test plan. During monitoring stage, we will have the feedbacks. In the analysis stage, we will have the test conditions. In the test design stage, we have the high level test cases. During test implementation, we have the test scripts or low level test cases. And during test execution, we have to see that whether we have run all the test cases and we got all the results. I hope it is now clear. Please pause the video and please try to remember these terms, associated documents with the test process. It is important. Now let's summarize all the points which we have covered till now. First, we saw test analysis. During test analysis, the test basis is analyzed to identify testable features and define associated test conditions. And here we ask the question, what to test? Next stage is test design. During test design, the test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases, set of high level test cases and other test wares. And here we ask the question, how to test? Next is test implementation. During test implementation, the test wares necessary for the test execution is created and completed, including sequencing the test cases into the procedures. And here we ask, is everything ready to test? We take care that whatever is required for the test execution is done during the test implementation stage. Test execution. During test execution, test suites are run in accordance with the test execution schedule. Here we are just running the test cases. And then we compare the results over here. And the last stage is the test completion stage. The test completion activity collects the data from the completed test activities to consolidate experiences, testware, and any other relevant informations. So here we have to see that whether we have collected all the data and experiences or not. These three terms are very important, and what we should ask, that is also important, and their outputs are also important. So from next topic, from now on, what we will see is we will see each of these test activities in detail. What are the tasks which we are going to do under this activity is what we are going to see in the next slide. And until now we saw the definition of test planning, test monitoring and control, test analysis, test design, test implementation, execution and completion. Now we are going to see the task which we need to perform under these activities. So we have a test process, these are the test activities, and now we have to know what is the task which we need to perform under these activities. So we'll start with the first activity, that is test analysis activity. And now we have to see what all tasks we are going to do under it. So this is the third activity we should know. Okay, so planning, monitoring, and then the analysis comes. We have already seen the definition of test analysis. During test analysis, the test basis is analyzed to identify testable features and define associated test conditions. So during this stage, we analyze the test basis, that means we analyze the requirement, and then we derive the test conditions. So these two points are very important. This is the task which we do under test analysis. So other than that, I will list down five major tasks which we perform under this activity, under test analysis. The first activity is analyze the test basis appropriate to the test level being considered. What it means is, at whichever test level you are in, you will have a different requirement. So we have to refer to that requirement. We have to analyze that requirement. So analyze the test basis appropriate to the test level being considered. Next, evaluating the test basis and test item to identify defect of various types. So when you are reading the test basis, that time you also have to see that what are the problem in those test basis. Okay, so we have to find the defect in the test basis. This is also part of test analysis, one of the activity or one of the task in the test analysis. Then identifying features and set of features to be tested. So this is a common one that we need to first identify what are the content which we can test. So we have to identify those things. So identifying features and set of features to be tested. So first we have to identify the features. Then define and prioritize the test condition for each feature based on the analysis of the test basis. So along with that, we have to define the test conditions. So first we have to analyze the requirement. We have to find the testable features. From that, we have to find out the test conditions. And then we have to prioritize those test conditions. Last one is capturing bi-directional traceability between test basis and test condition. So here for the test analysis, we have only two things. The input is test basis and the output is test condition. So we have to provide traceability between the output and the requirement. Let's understand this in more detail. So the first task which we perform under test analysis is analyze the test basis appropriate to the test level being considered. What does that mean is, so now I will list down the test levels and the test basis corresponding to the level. Suppose you are performing testing at functional level or non-functional component or system level. That is the behavior you want to see, functional and non-functional behavior. In that case, the requirement which you will get is requirement specification, business requirement, functional requirement, system requirement, user stories, epics, use cases, or similar work products. Any of these requirements you will get. Then you have to analyze this requirement if you are performing functional or non-functional related testing. Next level is, if you are at the component level or system level, if you are performing testing at these levels, then it is not necessary to go through all these documents. but then you will have some different set of documents like design and implementation related document, such as system or software architecture diagram, design specifications, flow graph, modeling diagrams like UML or interface specifications or similar work products. So what we want to understand here is we don't have to by heart these terms. We just need to know that when we are at different level, based on that level, we have to do our analysis. That test basis we have to analyze. So when you are at the integration testing level, we may get the implementation of the component or system itself, including code, database, metadata, and requires and queries and interfaces. So this could be the input when you are at this level. So you have to analyze this. All these things we will cover in detail in chapter number 2. For which level, what is the input? Okay, but for time being, I'm just giving you an overview. Then system testing. When you are at the system testing level, you need the risk analysis report, which may consider functional, non-functional, and structural aspect of the component or system. So some high level documents we need here. So at the end, you don't have to remember all these things. What you need to know is you have to analyze the test basis appropriate to the test level being considered, and that analysis is done in the test analysis stage. Moving further, evaluating the test basis and test item to identify defects of various types. So whatever is the test item, so in the analysis stage, the test item is test basis, because this is what you are getting as an input. So you have to analyze it. Why you have to analyze that? So test basis as an input, this is what you will get. Then you have to see that, is the requirement ambiguous? Is there any ambiguity? If you read the requirement, if you are not understanding something, if some information is missing, those things you have to point out when you are analyzing the requirement, when you are reading the requirement. So such type of mistakes you have to find. Next, omissions. If you see that some timing related informations are missing, or any other type of information, if you think that it is missing, then you have to point out during this stage. Inconsistencies. In one of the requirement they are telling something to do, in other requirement they are contradicting that. So inconsistencies in the requirement, the format is not maintained properly, such type of issues you can point out. Inaccuracies. So if you see that something is inaccurate in the requirement, you have to point it out. Contradictions, inconsistencies, contradictions, as I said, if you see something is mentioned in the first requirement and in the 10th requirement something else is mentioned, then that is a contradiction. And the superfluous statement, if the statement is completely false, that also you have to point out. How you will point out all these things? Only when you evaluate the test basis, if you evaluate the requirement. And that is what we have to do during the test analysis. We have to evaluate the test basis and test items to identify defects of various types. So this is the second point. Now moving forward to the third point, that is identifying features and set of features to be tested. So we already saw this. So we got this requirement that when the light should glow when the door is open, light should not glow when the door is closed or stop. Glowing. Then we found the testable features. From the testable feature, we got the test conditions. Okay, identify features and set of features to be tested. That is what we do during the test analysis stage. Once we get the features which we want to test, then what we do is we define and prioritize the test condition for each features based on analysis of the test basis. So the test analysis is the stage where test conditions are prioritized. That is what you need to know. This is a stage where you prioritize the test conditions based on multiple factors like functional and non-functional and structural characteristics, business and technical factors, level of risk. Based on the risk, you identify the feature. If it is a very risky feature, then you want to keep it on the top so that is tested first. Before we move further, we just need to know this, that define and prioritize test condition for each feature based on the analysis of the test basis is the fourth task which we do. The fifth task is capturing bidirectional traceability between test basis and test condition. What is the input to this level, to this activity? The input is test basis and the output is test conditions. So when we are in this stage, we have to provide the traceability between them, both of them. So this is the output of this stage, okay? Test basis is the input, test conditions are the output. So we have to provide the traceability between them. Traceability is nothing but the virtual link between the input document and the output document, so that we know this test condition is for this test basis or for this requirement. So this is what we do in this stage. So let's summarize all the points, all the tasks which we perform during test analysis. It is very important. Analyze the test basis appropriate to the test level being considered. So whichever level you are in, based on that you have to select the test basis and then you have to analyze it. When you are analyzing it, you also have to evaluate the test basis and test items. Why? To identify defects of various types. Identifying features and set of features to be tested. Define and prioritize test conditions for each features based on analysis of the test basis. And then capturing bidirectional traceability between test basis and test conditions. Fine. Last point will remain same, only new things will add, because when you go to the next stage, you will get next output. So for during the analysis stage, you only have test basis and test conditions. So only you have to provide bidirectional traceability between them. So you can pause the video and go through all the points before we proceed further. You need to remember all these points. They're quite important. So moving to the next stage, that is test design activity. Now we are going to see what are tasks which we perform during test design stage. So this is the fourth stage: test planning, test monitoring and control, test analysis, and then comes test design. Once you analyze the requirement, after that you can design the test cases. So we already saw the definition of test design. During test design, the test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases or set of high level test cases. So we got test conditions from where? From the analysis stage. So test condition is input to the test design stage and the output is high level test cases. So there are four major activities which we perform under this. The first one is designing and prioritization of test cases. Don't get confused. During test analysis, we designed or we defined and prioritized the test conditions. But during test analysis or test design, we design and prioritize the test cases. So test case is the word related to test design stage and set of test cases. Identifying necessary test data to support test conditions and test cases. Remember one point here again. During test design, we only identify the test data. You will understand why I am stressing this point over here when I cover test implementation. So again, I'm repeating. During test design stage, we only identify the test data. Okay, next. Design the test environment and identify any required infrastructure and tool. Again, during test design stage, we are only identifying the infrastructures which is required for testing. Last one, capturing bidirectional traceability between the test basis, test conditions, and what came new? Test cases, because that is what we are writing here. So test case is the last point. So these are the four major activities which we perform during the test design. Let's go through them one by one. Designing and prioritizing test cases and set of test cases. This is what we do in design stage. So we already know this is what we got in the test analysis stage. Derive test cases from the test conditions. So we have test conditions here. By looking into this, by analyzing it, we write the test design, where we write the high level test cases like this. Next. After we write the test cases, what we do is we prioritize the test cases. In the previous stage, test analysis, we prioritize the test condition. Here we prioritize the test cases. Next, Identifying necessary data to support test condition and test cases. So here we are only identifying the necessary data. For an example, this is the high level test cases. So what all data we need for the execution? So power supply, so we have a power supply for this is the data which we need. So we are identifying this is one data which we need. Then door status we need, what should when we can say the door is closed, when we can say the door is open. So for that we need the status. Similarly, when we can say that light is on, light is off, the status of the signal we need. So these are the three variables for which we need the data. So we are just identifying it in this stage. Next, designing the test environment and identifying any required infrastructure and tools. So here we are designing the test environment, that is fine, but we are only identifying the infrastructures. For an example, this is a test case which we want to run. For this test case, what all things we need? We need the computer, the software installed in it. We need the switch. We need the battery. We need the door assembly system. And we need the light. So we will just identify it. We will not assemble them. We will only identify the infrastructure. That's it. Next. Capturing bidirectional traceability between test bases, test conditions, and test cases. So in the previous stage, we provide the traceability between test bases and test conditions. In this stage, we provide the traceability between test condition and test design. So the first test condition, for the first test condition, this is the test case which we have written. For the second test condition, we have the second test case. So if we are at the second test case, if we right click, then we can see this link. So now we have the complete traceability until test cases. So let's summarize all the points which we or summarize all the tasks which we have to perform during the design stage. There are four tasks: designing and prioritizing the test cases and set of test cases, identifying necessary data to support test conditions and test cases, designing the test environment and identifying any required infrastructure and tool, capturing bidirectional traceability between the test bases, test condition, and test cases. I will stress on one point again. In test design stage, we only identify the test data and the infrastructure. We don't prepare them, we only identify them. So with this, we can move to the memory mapping. So what we need to know is, we saw two stages, test design stage and test analysis stage. So now we should be very clear what we do in the test design stage and what we do in the test analysis stage. For that, I have a exercise which we will do together. So this is the first line, okay? Designing of the test case. Where we do this? Analysis stage or design stage? So this is test case. Whenever you see test case, always related to the design stage. So we perform it during the design stage. So this is how you have to figure it out. Then prioritizing the test condition. In which stage we prioritize the test condition? Test condition is always related to analysis stage. So this is the answer. Next, prioritizing the test cases. So this is quite simple. We prioritize test cases during the design stage. So over here. Next, identifying the test condition. In which stage we identify test conditions? Obviously during the analysis stage. Here we have the requirement. Based on the requirement, we identify the test conditions. Then identifying necessary test data to support test cases. So identification of the test data is done during the design stage. So the answer is design. Next, identifying necessary test data to support test condition. Again, we are what we are doing is we are only identifying the test data. So this will be in design stage. Next, designing the test environment, obviously during the design stage. Next, identifying features and set of features to be tested. So when we analyze the requirement or test basis, that time we identify the features and set of features. So analysis stage. Next, evaluating the test basis and test item to identify defects of various type. So where we are evaluating the test basis in the analysis stage. So this is the point. Next one, capturing bidirectional traceability between the test basis, test condition and test cases, because test cases is here, that's why it is also done in the design stage. Whereas if you are reading this one, capturing bidirectional traceability between each element of the test basis and the associated test condition. So between test basis and test condition is the analysis, is the answer for this. So with this workshop, if you are able to answer everything, that means you have understood the topic, previous two topics. Next one, test implementation stage. So let's see what are activities or tasks we do during the test implementation. Remember first point, that is, this is the fifth stage. Test planning, test monitoring, test analysis, test design, then comes the test implementation. During test implementation, the test wares necessary for the test execution is created or completed, including sequencing the test cases into test procedures. So here the main task of test implementation is that we have to make everything ready which is required for the test execution stage. And that is what you will see here also. So here we have six major activities or task. First, again, developing and prioritizing test procedures. So whenever you see the term test procedures, it is related to test implementation. Test condition is related to test analysis. Test case is related to test design, and test procedure is related to test implementation stage and potentially creating automated test scripts. So test scripts, test procedures are used for the manual testing. Test scripts are used for the automation testing. That is the only difference between test procedure and test scripts. So both the terms we can relate it to test implementation stage. Next, creating test suites from the test procedure. So creation of test suites. You remember what is the meaning of test suite? Test suite is nothing but collection of test scripts. Okay. So creating test suites from the test procedure and automated test scripts. So we can create a test suite of the test procedure as well as automated test scripts. That means we can arrange test procedures in one group or we can arrange test scripts in one group. And the group is called test suites. Next, arranging the test suites within a test execution schedule in a way that result in efficient test execution. So we have to arrange the test suites within the test execution schedule in a way that we achieve the efficient testing. Fourth point, building the test environment. This is the point I was talking about. So during test implementation, we build the test environment, whereas we identify the test environment during the design stage. That includes potentially test harness. It is very important. This line is very important. Preparation of the test harness is done during the test implementation stage. Service virtualization, simulators, and other infrastructure items. Whatever item you need for your testing is built during the test implementation stage. And the examples are test harness, service virtualization, simulators, and other infrastructure. Not only building that, we also have to verify that everything needed has been set up correctly. So we have to build and then we have to check that everything is working fine. This is the task of the test implementation stage. Next point, preparing test data. Identification of test data is done in the design stage, whereas preparation of the test data is done in the test analysis stage. Sorry, test implementation stage. And we also have to ensure that the data, whatever we are preparing, we can load it to the test environment. So again, verification is required. Last point is a very simple one. Verifying the and updating the bidirectional traceability between test basis, test conditions, test cases, and two new terms, test procedure and test suites. Test procedure for the manual testing and test suites for the automated testing. So if you see these two terms, they are related to the test implementation stage. Now let's see each of these terms in detail. So during test implementation, we develop and prioritize test procedures and potentially create automated test scripts. So this is the test case which we have. What we can do is we can arrange them in a test procedure. We can arrange them, or we can also make test script out of that. Test procedure is for the manual testing, and test script is for the automated testing. So that is what we have to do. So we have to develop and prioritize the test procedure and the test cases, test scripts. Next, creating test suites from the test procedure or test script. So we wrote the test script or test procedure, right? So this is the test, consider this as a test procedure or test scripts. Now we have to create a test suite. So what is test suite? Test suite is nothing but grouping the test cases in some order. So these test suites, we can arrange them in this order. So this, but all this set of test cases are referred as test suites. So this is what we have to do during the test implementation stage. Now this test suite we will load to the test execution tool, and they will execute sequentially. Next step, arranging the test suite within the test execution schedule. So we will not prepare only one test suite. We can prepare multiple test suites of different test cases, and then we have to schedule them in an order, that which test suite will run first, which test suites will run second, which test suite will run third. Next. Now we have to build the test environment and verify that everything needed has been set up correctly. So if you remember, during the design stage, we only identified these stuff, these infrastructures. During the test implementation, we will assemble them in a logical order, so that when you press the button or when you give the command, then all these things will work properly. Along with that, so when we say these things, the examples are test harness, as I said, service virtualization, and simulators. These are the examples, and also we have to see that they are working fine. Next one, preparing test data and ensuring it is properly loaded in the test environment. Again, if you remember, this is the test data which we identified during the test design stage. Now we have to fill this data based on our project. So this is the data we will prepare. Okay, power supply, we need 12 volt. Door status, when we get 0 as a signal, then it is off. When we get 1 as a signal, that means it is on. So like that, we have to prepare the data. We have to fill, or we have to assign values to these variables. Okay, this is the point. And the last point, verifying and updating bi-directional traceability between the test bases, test condition, test cases, test procedure, and test suites. So till now we had the traceability between bases and condition, then between condition and design. Now using this design or test cases, we wrote the test script. So we have to provide traceability for that also. So this is the last task which we perform in the test implementation stage. So let's summarize all the points which we have seen till now. First point is developing and prioritizing test procedure and test scripts. Creating test suites from the test procedure and test scripts. Arranging the test suite in a test execution schedule. Building the test environment such as test harness, service virtualization, simulators. Preparing the test data. Preparation of the test data happens here. Verifying and uploading bidirectional traceability between test bases, test condition, test cases, test procedure, and test suites. So these two terms are new terms over here. With this, test implementation or the task of test implementation is done. Now, again, we will do an exercise so that we know the difference between all the stages. So here, if you see, we have three stages: analysis, design, and implementation. So the task will come, and then you have to differentiate between the activities. Developing test script. So test script is the word associated with implementation. So implementation is the answer over here. Prioritized test condition. Okay, when we are prioritizing the test condition. So test condition is a word related to analysis. during analysis. Prioritizing test cases. Test case is the term related to design. So here, next. Prioritizing test procedures. The procedure is a term which will come for the implementation. So here, next. Building the test environment. So building of the test environment is done in the implementation stage. Identifying necessary test data. So identification of the test data happens in design stage. Okay, next. Designing the test environment. When we design the test environment, designing happens in the design stage. Next. Identifying features and set of features to be tested. It is in the analysis stage. Next. Preparing test data and ensuring it is properly loaded to the test environment. So preparation of the data happens in implementation stage. Next. What is test? When we ask this question, what is test? Where we ask this question during the analysis stage, what should we test? Verifying and updating bidirectional traceability between the test bases, test condition, test cases, test procedure and test suites. So test procedure and suites are the term related to implementation stage. So that is where we have to do it. Okay. There are a few more. So we will go through them also. Creating test suites. So test suite is a term related to test implementation stage. So it is done there. Developing test procedure. Again, procedure is a term related to implementation stage. So here it will come. Service virtualization. This word is also example of the environment, test environment. So test implementation. Verifying that everything needed has been set up correctly. Implementation stage. Identifying necessary test data. So identification of the test data happens in design stage. Building test harness and simulator. So building of the test harness and simulator is done in the implementation stage. Next. Designing the test environment. As we know, designing happens in the design stage. Verifying that everything needed has been set up correctly in the implementation stage. Next. Evaluating the test bases and test item to identify defects of various types. When we are evaluating the test bases requirement to find the defect in the analysis stage. Next. Capturing bidirectional traceability between the test bases, test condition and test cases. So test cases is a term related to design stage. And the last one. Capturing bidirectional traceability between each element of the test bases and the associated test condition. So it is stopping at test condition. That's why it is in the analysis stage. So I hope all the points are clear now and we are able to differentiate between the task, which task we have to perform in the analysis stage, which task we have to perform in the design stage, and which all tasks we have to perform in the implementation stage. Let's move to the next activity, that is the test execution. During test execution, which is the sixth stage, test planning, test monitoring and control, test analysis, test design, test implementation, and then comes the test execution. I'm repeating it again and again so that you remember these points. Test execution. During test execution, test suites are run in accordance with the test execution schedule. So where we make this test execution schedule? During the implementation stage. Based on that schedule, we have to run our test cases or test suites. So here we have 8 major tasks under test execution activity. We have 8 major tasks. The first one is recording the IDs and versions of the test item, test object, test tool and testware. So whatever we prepared in the implementation stage, we have to keep a record of all these things in execution stage. Next. Executing tests either manually or by using test execution tool. So now if it is a manual environment, then you will perform the testing manually. If you have the test execution tool and scripts, then you can perform it automatically also. Comparing actual result with expected result. So here you are running the test cases. So therefore You can compare the actual result with the expected result. Analyzing anomalies to establish their likely causes. So you are comparing the result, and if there is any issue, if there is any deviation, that means that is called as anomalies, that is referred as anomalies. So we have to analyze the anomalies, we have to analyze the defects. Reporting defects based on the failures observed. So first we have to compare, if there is a deviation we have to analyze, after analysis we have to provide the report. Next, logging the outcome of test execution. So after execution we will have certain outcomes, like how many test cases passed, how many test cases failed, how many test cases could not execute. So we have to log all these things, we have to document it. 7. Repeating test activities either as a result of action taken from an anomaly or as a part of planned testing. So we can also repeat the test activities. So if some test cases failed and now they are fixed, then we can rerun them. So that activities also we have to perform during the test execution. And the last one, verifying and updating bi-directional traceability between the test bases, test conditions, test cases, test procedures and test results, because this is a stage where we will get the test results because we are executing our test cases. Let's go through each of these points one by one. Recording the IDs and versions of the test item. So we saw that during test implementation we assembled all these things. Now during the test execution we have to record it, which software we used, which part number of the switch we used, battery, what was the supply voltage of that battery, which door assembly system we use for our testing, what is the part number of the light which we use for testing. All these things we have to record. So recording of the IDs and versions are done in the test execution stage. Executing tests either manually or by using the test execution tool. So you have the complete list, you can execute them manually or you can use them, execute them automatically, it's up to you. Next, comparing actual result with the expected result. So what happens here is you have the test execution tool. So you also have a test cases, different test cases. These test cases you will pass to the tool and then you will get the result out of the tool. This result then you will compare with the expected result. So expected result, where it will be stored? It will be stored in test oracle. So from there you will get the data and you will do the comparison. If both are same, then you say the test case is passed. If both are deviated or both are not same, then you say test case is failed. Okay, so comparing actual result with the expected result is done in the test execution stage. Next, analyzing anomalies to establish their likely causes. So what we do here is these many test cases we will pass through the tool. Then after that we will compare the result and then we know that okay, these are the test cases passed, these are the test cases failed. Now we have to find out the root cause of this failure. Likely causes means because of the test environment it failed, or it failed because of the software is faulty. Because the software is faulty, it failed. So we have to list them down and then we have to assign some attributes, like which all test cases passed, failed. We have to also assign their reasons why they failed, which requirement failed because of that, and what is the priority. All these things we have to list down. So this is what we have to do, analyzing anomalies to establish their likely causes. Next, reporting defects based on the failures observed. Now we have to report the defects. So we have identified on the all the reasons, and we see that if we see that all the reasons are because of the software only, because software is faulty, that's why we found all these defects, then we have to report all these defects to the development team. Logging out the outcome of the test execution. As I said, how many test cases passed, how many test cases failed, all this data we have to log, maybe in the form of a pie chart or any other representation. 7. Repeating test activity either as a result of action taken for the anomaly. So we say that okay, this test case failed because of the faulty software. Now if they fix the problem, then we have to retest them. So that is also part of the test execution. Last one is quite simple. Verifying and updating bidirectional traceability between test basis, test condition, test cases, test procedure and test result. So until now, here we completed the traceability and now we have the result, then we have to provide the traceability between that. So if you open any report, then you can see that it is for which requirement. You can also see the requirement. That is why traceability is very, very important. At any stage, if you go, you have the complete data. What is how they are related, what is the relationship between them that you can establish. So let's summarize all the points which we saw for test execution. So 8 tasks we saw: recording the IDs and versions of the test item, recording, you remember this thing, executing test either manually or using a tool, comparing actual result and expected result, if they are different then analyze the anomalies, report the defects, log the outcome of the test execution, repeat the test activities, and verify the bidirectional traceability along with the test result. Now again, let's do an exercise so that we remember these terms. So now we have to differentiate between implementation and execution stage. That's it. Developing test procedure and potentially creating automated test scripts. So where we develop procedure and test scripts, obviously during the implementation stage. Next, logging the outcome of the test execution. So where we log the outcomes, we log it during the execution stage. Next, executing tests manually, where we execute, it's very common, execution stage. Next, creating test suit from the test procedures. Test suits are created during the implementation stage. Repeating test activities either as a result of action taken for an anomaly. So where we are repeating the test activities, during the execution stage. Next, prioritizing test procedure, where we prioritize test procedure, implementation stage. Next, preparing the test data. Preparation of the test data happens in implementation stage. Identification happens in the design stage. Comparing actual result with the expected result. So comparison also happens in the execution stage. Next, ensuring it is properly loaded in the test environment. Okay, it means test data. So ensuring that we ensure during the implementation stage. Next, verifying and updating bidirectional traceability between the test basis, test condition, test cases, test procedure and test suits. It stops at this point, so implementation stage. Last one, verifying bidirectional traceability between all the things along with the test result. Then it is a execution stage. So with this, you should know the difference between test analysis, design, implementation and execution. The last topic of test process, that is test completion. So this is the last stage and here we do a lot of things. First thing is, in the test completion stage, we collect the data from the completed test activities to consolidate the experiences. So all the experience, good, bad, whatever, we try to consolidate. And any other relevant information along with the test wares. So this is a place where we do the collection of the data. So here we have 6 major activities. First one is checking whether all defect reports are closed. Creating the test summary report. Finalizing and archiving the test environment. Handling over the test ware to the maintenance team or other project team members. Analyzing lessons learned. This is very important point. Lesson learned is analyzed during the test completion stage. Using the information gathered to improve the test process maturity. So whatever information we get out of this stage will be used for the improvement purpose. That is the main idea. Let's see each of this point in detail now. Checking whether all the defect reports are closed. So this is the defect report which we prepared. Developers will fix this, and after that we have to perform retesting to see that they are fixed or not, and then we have to update this result. And during the completion stage we will see that whether all the reports are passed or not, all the test cases are passed or not. So checking happens in the completion stage. Then creating a test summary report to communicate to the stakeholder. So after that report, finally the manager or the team lead will create a final summary report, which will include how many test cases passed and failed and their severity, and that will be shared with the stakeholders. Finalizing and archiving the test environment, test data, test infrastructure and other. Whatever thing you produce during that testing phase, everything you have to archive, you have to store, so that in future if any issue comes, then you can retrieve it and then perform the testing on that. Next, handling over the testware to the maintenance team. So whatever things we have stored, we will hand it over to the maintenance team, because maintenance can happen after 5 years also. So if any defect is found after fifth year, then the maintenance team will take care of that. For that, they should have the environment stored somewhere. Fifth, analyzing lessons learned from the complete test activities to determine changes needed for future iterations, releases, and projects. So whatever testing we did, based on that we will have a lesson learned session where all the stakeholders will meet, they will discuss, they will have a meeting over there. This is done for the improvement purpose, like to see how we can make testing more efficient, productivity, how can we write test case in a quality wise, and team satisfaction, whether the team was satisfied with the last release or not. Then whatever information we gather from the lesson learned will be used to improve the test process maturity. So all the information which we get during the testing, that is also called as a retrospective meeting, those data will be used for the improvement purpose. So this is all the tasks which we do during the test completion. Let's summarize all the points. Checking whether all defect reports are closed. Creating a test summary report to be communicated to the stakeholders. Finalizing and archiving the test environments. All the outputs which we have produced during the testing phase, we have to archive it, store it. Then handling over the testware to the maintenance team. Analyzing the lesson learned for the improvement purpose. And then using the gathered information to improve the test process maturity. So these are the tasks which we perform during the test completion stage. Next topic is quite easy if you have understood the previous topic, test work product. What are the output which we get from the test activities? That is what we are going to see, and this is going to be our third topic. The outputs are mentioned in the test work product is mentioned in ISO 29.119.3. In 2, we have test process, and in 3, we have the outputs. So first of all, we need to know what is test work product, what is the meaning of work product. Work product is output of the test activity. Any test activity you do or any task you do, whatever is the output, that is referred as work product. So we have these activities, and whatever output we are getting from these activities are referred as test work product, and that is what we are going to see in this lecture, that what we get from the planning stage, what we get from the monitoring stage, what output we get from the analysis stage, likewise for the other stages. So for the planning stage, the output is obviously the test plan. Then comes the exit criteria and the traceability information. So during the planning stage, we say that when we can say that when we should stop the testing, the exit criteria will be mentioned. Traceability related information between which all work product we need the traceability is decided in the planning stage. Monitoring. Test progress report. Test summary report. So progress report when the things are working during the time, and summary report when the things are done. Then audience relevant report and report addressing project management concerns. So different types of report we can prepare. For the customer, there will be a different report. For manager, for team lead, like team lead needs the detailed report. So like that, we will prepare the report during the monitoring stage. So coming to the test analysis stage, what are the outputs? Defined and prioritized test conditions. So we already know test conditions are prepared during the analysis stage. So defined and prioritized test conditions are the output. Creation of test charter is also the output. So what is test charter? A test charter provides the test conditions to cover during the time boxed testing session. What does this mean is, we will define the time like for 2 hours. How you have to use the system? What is the purpose? Setup, priority, references. All these things we will provide for testing for the 2 hours. Within 2 hours, we will decide the time. That is a time boxed testing session. So 2 hours we will give it to the tester and we will tell, test the feature based on the user. So that is what is mentioned in the test charter. What should be the role of the tester? What is the purpose of this testing? Everything will be mentioned in the test charter. But from exam point of view, this is not important. Just for your reference, that test charter provides test conditions to cover during the time-based testing session. Defect in the test basis. So all the defects which we find during the analysis stage is also the output. So 3 outputs we get from the test analysis stage: defined and prioritized test conditions, creation of test charter, defects in the test basis. Next, test design. Test cases and set of test cases. So we know that we design these things, so output is the test case. Design and identification of the test data. Design of the test environment and identification of the infrastructure and tools. So this is quite simple. Whatever we discussed in the previous stage, those are the outputs now. When you're in the implementation stage, test procedure and sequencing of that test procedure. So sequencing of the test procedure we do in the test implementation stage. So that is the output. Test suites are the output. Test execution schedule is the output. Service virtualization is the word used there. Service virtualization and automated test scripts are the output. Creation and verification of test data and test environment is the output. So creation of the test data happens in implementation stage. Test condition defined in test analysis may be further refined in test implementation. So during test analysis or test design, what we do is we write the high level test cases that we can make it into the low level during the test implementation stage. This is also a very important point. High level test cases are designed during the design stage. Low level test cases are designed during the implementation stage. Next, test execution. What is the output of the test execution? I think it's quite simple. Documentation of the status of individual test cases or test procedure. Like how many test cases are run or ready to run, pass, fail, blocked, deliberately we have skipped for this release, all this information. Defect report. This is what we prepare during the execution stage. And documentation about which test item, object, tool, and version were involved in the testing. So, providing the IDs to the test environment. And when we talk about test completion, test summary report, action item for improvement, we do the retrospective meeting, in that we get the action items. change request or product blocking, product backlogs. Product backlog means during first round of testing, if you tested certain features and you missed certain features or you skipped certain features, those features will come under product backlogs, and those features you have to test in the next release. So that documentation is also done in the completion stage. And finalized test wears, all the outputs will be finalized in this stage. So that is the outcome. So I hope these points were quite easy, because if you understand the previous topic, the task, then whatever task you do, that is the outcome over here. Nothing new. Then we also have to provide the bi-directional traceability. So these are the different stages which we have. By now we know that, right? Out of these stages, these four stages are very important. And because during the test analysis, we get the test basis, we analyze the test basis. From test basis, what we do is we get test conditions. From test conditions, since we get the test condition, we have to provide the traceability between these two. Then from test condition, we write the high level test cases. So we have to provide the traceability between them. After high level test cases, we define the test procedures. So now we provide the traceability between these two. And during the execution, we get the result. So we have to also provide the traceability between it. So this is how all the outputs are traceable with the bi-directional traceability. Anyway, this traceability concept we will cover in detail in the upcoming lecture now. So now let's summarize the topic. So during the work product of the planning stage is test plan, exit criteria, traceability information. Monitoring stage is test progress report, summary report, and reports for the different stakeholders. And these are the other work products. So you can take a screenshot of it, because everything is there in one place. I'm not going to go through them again now. So you can pause the video and go through it, or you can take the screenshot also for your future reference. Now we will cover the last topic, that is the traceability related. Okay, so this is the last topic of test process. Explain the value of maintaining traceability between the test basis and test work product. What is the importance of traceability? That is what we need to know. First, we need to know what is the meaning of traceability. So you have the test basis. This is the point. From test basis, you write test conditions. You get the test condition. From test condition, you write the test designs. By going through the test design, in the implementation stage, you write the test scripts. And then in the execution stage, you execute them and you get the result. Then we can provide the traceability between test basis and test condition, so that we know for these test conditions came from this requirement. Then the test condition 1 can be linked to test case 1, then to script 1, and then to the result. Similarly, we can provide the traceability between other stuffs also. Now we need to know, why are we doing this? Okay, so that is the next. Why traceability is required? First point, to implement effective test monitoring and control process. If we have the traceability, we know that how many requirements we wrote the test cases, right? With all the requirement, with means all the requirement with links, shows that we have a test case for that. With that, we can get the coverage. So to implement effective test monitoring and control process. Next, revert to the test planning. So if we say that within 10 days we have to complete 50 test cases and we see only two links, then we can revisit to the planning and complete do the control activity. Third, communication to the stakeholder. We can communicate to the stakeholder how much percentage of the work is done. So that is why traceability is required. 3 points. To implement effective test monitoring and control procedure, so that we can revert to the test planning and communication to the stakeholders. Now we will see the importance of traceability. Previously we saw why traceability is required, and now the importance. for analyzing the impact of changes. If the requirement changes, then we can see that it has impact on which all test cases. So for analyzing the impact of the changes, for example, if this requirement is changed, in that case we know that okay, since the condition is changed here, this test case we need to change, this test script we need to change, and finally the result will change. So for this tracking, next, making testing auditable. So we can audit during, if someone from the external comes and asks us where you have tested this requirement, with the help of link we can show them. Next, meeting IT governance criteria. Same thing for the governance related criteria. If there is a government regulatory agencies which want to see whether the requirements are fulfilled or not, government related requirements are fulfilled or not, so if we have a traceability we can show them yes, the government related requirements are covered under these test cases. Then improving the understandability of the test progress report and test summary report to include the status of the element of the test basis. So in the report also we can say that this test case failed and it has an impact on this requirement, because if we have a traceability then only we can do that. This is one point. Fifth point, relating the technical aspect of the testing to the stakeholder in terms that they can understand. So if we have the traceability, then we can provide the matrices in the form of pie chart or any other simplest form which the stakeholder can understand. Last one, providing information to assess product quality. If we have the traceability, we know that how many requirements failed, right? So that will give us like whether we have a good quality or not, what is the capability of our process, and project progress against the business goal. So if we can trace everything, we can find out whether we are reaching what is the business goal or not. So with this topic, what we did is we covered the big portion of chapter 1. We covered what is testing, why is testing necessary, 7 testing principles, and different test processes. Thank you.